everybody. Hi, it is November. Is this the second? November 2nd, 2022. Welcome. So good to see you guys here. Thank you for joining me. We've got a lot of great things planned for our time together today. We're going to actually talk about cables and how to machine quilt cables, which is a super, super traditional hand quilting design. And we're just going to modify it slightly so that it's a little easier to do on a machine, whether you're using a stand-up machine or a sit-down machine. So we're going to play a little bit with a smiley ruler and how to make cables on a quilt using your machine. So I hope you guys are doing well. I know here we just got back from Houston. We went down to Quilt Market and got to see all of the new lines of fabric and all the designers and all the notions and goodies and tools. And I tell you what, it was actually really, really good just to see everybody in person again. You know, it had been a really long time since I had gathered with other folks in the quilting industry and that on that scale. And it was just good to get a lot of hugs. So I got to see some old friends and make some new ones, and we had a good time. And the World Series, it was going on like the next block over from the Houston Quilt Show. So lots of very enthusiastic people dressed in orange roaming through the streets, including we saw, I think it's called a rickrack. Is it called a rickrack? Where it's like a big, it's a bicycle that has like a wagon on the back, and so you sit on it and then they drive,
a rickshaw.
And this poor gentleman had six grown men in the back of his bicycle, and he was making it work. I mean, it was impressive. And they were all headed down to the World Series game. So there's a lot of hubbub and activity in downtown Houston, but as always, it was really great to see everybody. So I wanted to be sure that you are signed up for our Quilted Joy newsletter. We have a lot of great stuff going on in our newsletter. It's also how you get access to all of our downloadable worksheets that you may enjoy having, as well as any information that we have about upcoming events or specials. And we are also including in our newsletter for this month some information about our design along. So I'm going to talk to you about that here in a moment, but be sure that you are signed up. It's how to get access to all of our info and tutorials. And then on November the 16th at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific, we will have an Ask Me Anything here in the clubhouse, or we can just chat about whatever you want to chat about. But we are going to be talking specifically about the birds in the air block. So birds in the air is a super, super traditional block, and it's typically made with very small triangles. And when you get done, you question all of your life choices because it's just way too many little triangles to deal with. And so we came up with a way to do a birds in the air block four at a time. Mind blowing. And so when we gather for our Ask Me Anything, so that is on November the 16th, I'm going to show you how to make that super traditional birds in the air block, not at a little tiny triangles, but four at a time. And then you're going to cut it north, south, east, west, and you got your birds in the air block. It is so, so cool. So make sure that you join us. And of course, we do record all of these. If you wanted to go back and rewatch it, or you're not able to join us live, you can do that. You can watch all the recordings. And then I wanted to tell you, I know that Christmas is coming up and you probably are working on quilts to get done for presents. And if you are needing your quilts done by Christmas, we still have openings. So we do have our quilt by mail program, and we are now offering it at 20% off. If you make a reservation for services within 2022, you will get 20% off your mail-in quilting charge. So we just require a $50 deposit for a reservation, and then you would ship your quilt top to us. Our quilt fairies would quilt it and ship it back to you, and we can get it back to you in time for Christmas. So if you're looking for someone who still has Christmas openings, we certainly have them. And I wanted to tell you, if you are interested in APQS machines, we do have a roadshow coming up here in Louisville, Kentucky. That will be on November the 12th. And we will have all of the machines loaded with fabrics that you can go from machine to machine to machine and play and get information. And it's really designed for folks who are in the market for a long arm machine. And we'll go through all the different features that you could kind of figure out which feature, which one speaks to you, which is important to you as you kind of drill down. what machine is best. So I'd love to have you join me for the roadshow here in Louisville, Kentucky at Quilted Joy. You can sign up for that on our website. You can also give us a ring if you'd like to do that, and we can get you signed up. And then November, every month, we have a release of our thread bundle. And so the November thread bundle is going to be our Snuggle Sprite. And this three-pack is Arabian, Sangria, and Space. So those three colors, they're all glide thread. You can get the thread bundle either in the King cone or in the 1,000 meter mini cone. Either one, we have them both ways. But that's our curated bundle for this month, is the Snuggle Sprite. And that'll only be up for the month of November. So after November, we'll have a different bundle for you to look at. But this one is only available here in the month of November. So check that out. All right, do we have folks filing in, Jesse?
We do.
Yeah, where are you guys, where are they coming in from? Hey, Becky in South Carolina.
Linda from Nevada.
Linda in Nevada.
We've got Fran from Kansas.
Fran in Kansas.
Let's see. Tina's in Michigan.
Hey, Tina in Michigan.
And Megan's in upstate New York.
Megan in upstate New York. I bet it's chilly there, Megan. I wonder if you've got good leaves still up there in upstate New York. I know ours are, it's like almost past that prime view. This last week, right before I went to Houston, I was in Knoxville, and we drove through the Great Smoky Mountain National Forest, and the colors were unbelievable. Maybe I'll show you the picture, because my husband took a photo at the top of this mountain. We didn't realize how cold it was going to be at the top of the mountain, because he was in shorts and a t-shirt, and I was like in a scarf and a hat, and anyway, he took a really gorgeous photo. So I'll show you that when we join on November the 16th. It was truly a really beautiful photo of the Smoky Mountains in fall. Okay, so let's talk about cables. Let's talk about how to quilt cables. And you know, cables, as a hand quilter, you can kind of interlock them easily. So cables typically have like one wave of lines that duck in under another wave of lines. And when you're hand quilting, it's easy to kind of do that. When you're machine quilting, it's a little harder, and there's some backtracking that happens, so it can be more of a challenge. And so anytime you're kind of thinking about how to bend a traditional hand quilted design for a stand-up machine or sit-down machine, it's gonna look a little different, but it'll have the same kind of overall effect. And so what we're gonna use for this is actually the Smiley Ruler. This one is made by Creative Grids. It was designed by Angela Walters, and it has some really great marks on it. So one thing is that on the back of all the Creative Grids rulers, there's kind of like this, it's kind of like a, I don't know how to even describe it. It's like grippy along the outside edge. And then it has a lot of different marks. So I'm interested in this mark here, the straight line mark. And I've got a straight line marked through the middle of this border. And this is a 6-inch border. And we've used this before. You can see this is what's our swag class that we did earlier in the year. And this ruler has a little notch in it that's just perfect for the hopping foot. And then I'm going to align this ruler with that line that I've put through the equator, through the middle of my border, and then I'm just gonna hop over my little Smiley ruler until I hit the mark again. And then once I hit it, I'm gonna flip this around, and now I'm gonna go this other side. Again, I'm using that straight edge of the ruler, and I'm just gonna hold it with as many fingers as I have available. And then I'm gonna go to this side, and I'm just gonna do three, I think, of these. So I've gone, up, down, and over the top. And then I'm gonna hit that line. Okay, so now I've done that one serpentine line, and I'm gonna come back. So I'm just gonna flip this back over. Again, I'm gonna put that divot around the hopping foot, line up that straight line, hold it with as many fingers as I have available. And come back to the equator, and then flip this over. And you would keep going, right? You would do as many as these as you wanted to fill the space. Stop at the equator, and I'm going to flip this over, and then that way we will have three of these done. All right, I'm going to just take some tacking stitches. I think I moved the camera. Ashley, is that better? Okay. I think I knocked it with my hand. All right, so I just took some tacking stitches and I'm gonna cut my threads there, and then I'm just gonna take you on a little tour. So here's what we just did, which would be beautiful. And you could see, like, you could even fill that with like ribbon candy or wishbones, and that would be a fine border. But let's repeat this, okay? Let's just do the same thing that we just did again. So I'm gonna bring up my bobbin thread, and I've just gone an inch away, and again, drawn another line an inch away, lining up that line, holding it with all the fingers I have available, hopping over, repositioning, line, fingers. So it's going to overlap just a little bit. And depending on how many repeats you do and how much you overlap, you'll get very different looks. All right, I'm going to come on back and we'll take a look at what it looks like with these two. Put there in the comments, says, have you guys, how do you feel about hand quilting? Have you hand quilted, let's say, have you hand quilted more than 5 quilts? Let's put that. If you have hand quilted more than 5 quilts, put a yes there in the comments. If you have not hand quilted more than 5 quilts, put a no there in the comments. And I will say for me, it's a no. I've done one, and that was, enough, because I don't have that kind of patience. I do like to do handwork for binding, but not so much the quilting side of the world. My little plates are spinning so fast, it has to be machine. Okay, so there's two overlapped, which again would be beautiful, right? You could stop right there. I like how it makes little diamonds in between. Very nice, right? All right, let's do a third pass. Jesse, is anybody chiming in?
Definitely so far, mostly no.
No's? Yeah.
And my favorite response, no, hand is a four-letter word.
Yeah, hand is a four-letter word. That's funny. Yeah, there are some things I do enjoy doing by hand, but it is not the quilting process for sure. So you can see how easy this goes, and we're just using the shallow side of the smiley ruler. Notice that the other side is deeper, so you could do the same thing, just use the deeper side if you wanted a different look, and it depends on how big the border is. So a lot of times a big border can be intimidating, and so this would be an easy thing to pop into a big border, because you could fill it. It just depends on how many, you know, repeats you want to do of the ruler. All right, we'll go over one more. Yeah, so in Houston, we got to see Tula Pink's new block of the month, and of course she's amazing. And so that's all done by hand, and it does look fun. Like, I think the fun part of that for me would be the fussy cutting part of it, to kind of explore the fabric and the little items in the fabric in a new kind of fun way. All right, I'm gonna break my threads, and then we're gonna take a look at how this design looks stitched out. So there's three repeats, and don't you love how it gives this kind of diagonal diamond look in there? So you could call it a day with two, you could call it a day with one. You saw what it looked like with one, you saw what it looked like with two, and here's three. And I could keep going, you know, just another 1-inch line up here, and I could keep interweaving them. But that is an easy way to make cables. And what I used was the smiley ruler, made by Creative Grids, designed by Angela Walters. And we use the shallow side, but you could also do it. It would look differently with the larger curve. So was there a question?
I pulled
this one. This is my latest favorite one. This one is the Mark Be Gone. So one side is air erasable and one side is water erasable. And so I just use the blue, the water erasable here. Sometimes in Kentucky, it depends on the humidity level. That air erasable side, if it's humid out, it won't last very long, but it really goes on beautifully. It just kind of like butter goes on. So what we'll do is later we'll take these marks out with just a little paintbrush with water and they'll come right out. Any other questions? Yeah, bunny hop. Yeah, you could just bunny hop. So you could do like all of the top, hop, hop, hop. You could certainly do that. The only reason I don't do that is that it's just that where they intersect is just cleaner if you go through than if you hop. So that bounce, sometimes you can get a lot of stack stitches in there and it just doesn't look as clean to me. So I prefer to flip it. But absolutely, if your brain is better at, you know, bunny hop to here, and then bunny hop to here, and then bunny hop to here, and then flip it and go back the other way. So bunny hop to there, you absolutely can do that. So totally works. If that works better for your brain, do it that way. You can do it either way. Any other questions?
Just your thoughts on the corners. We have a couple
people. Yeah, so corners. So corners with cables are going to be more difficult. And what I would say to you is to plan this design out without turning a corner at first until you get to know it, and draw it on paper first. So make a mock-up on paper, draw your miter, and go around a corner. I don't have an empty corner on this quilt to show you, but it's not gonna look quite the same as a hand-quilted cable would around the corner. So play with different ways to turn the corner, but I would just do a simple arc over to the next beginning point to take it down the side of the quilt. And then I would just chunk it. So if you're on a long arm machine, I would do what I can reach between the bars in one pass. So I would go up on the left, go across the top, down to the right, roll it forward, left side, right side, roll it forward, left side, right side, roll it forward, and obviously quilt in between those. But that's how I would chunk the borders as I go down to complete the quilt. All right, so I want to be sure that we thank our sponsor, APQS. APQS machines are 100% handcrafted in Iowa. They are loved the world over, and they come with a lifetime warranty. If you are interested in APQS long arm machines, give us a call here at Quilted Joy, and we'd be happy to chat with you further. Of course, you can also contact your local APQS store, your local APQS dealer, or you can go to apqs.com for more info. Thanks so much, APQS. We love you. Okay, I have a looky-loo to show you today. Now, I will tell you that the audio is a little weird in places, so you'll just have to forgive me for that. But I wanted you to see, this is Emily's studio, and I'm not gonna give away the big reveal because you're gonna love her space. Let's take a look at Emily's sewing room.
All right. Hey, Emily, thanks for joining me.
Hello, thanks for having me.
Yeah, and where are you located, Emily? What state are you in?
I'm in Ames, Iowa, central Iowa.
Fabulous. And so your home is in your studio, right? Your studio is in your home, right?
My studio is in my home. I'm a basement dweller.
Fabulous. That's where my studio was for a very long time. Well, can you turn the camera around? I'd love to see your studio.
Sure. So I don't want to be nervous, but there is a bit of a celebrity here in my studio.
Oh, yeah?
You'll see.
Okay. Oh my goodness, the queen.
Yes, Her Majesty, has quality control here.
Where did you happen to find the queen?
Well, my parents had their 50th wedding anniversary last year, and we were going to go to England together, but with COVID and everything, we brought England to them. So I found this cardboard cutout on Amazon and bought her. So she attended the festivities.
I see a lot of folks who are new to long arm quilting, and they hold the handles way too tight. And I always say to them, no, use your Queen of England muscles.
Well, there you go.
Like, put your fingers up and not hold so tight. So that's great. Well, so Emily, you have a long arm machine there. I see. What long arm do you have?
I'll back up here. She's Lucy.
Lucy, and is that a 10-foot table, 12-foot table?
12.
A 12-foot table. Lovely. And I see you've got behind her, is that your design wall?
Yes, I've got my design wall here.
So many colors.
Yes, so as you can tell, I love having color in my space.
And so were you piecing over there? You panned to the right, and I saw.
Yeah. So let me scooch back that way. So there's where I, my sewing machine and my computer. So it's my sewing machine and my desk. And,
wonderful.
Yes, I have a pile here of more pieces for that, this star quilt that I'm working
on. That's fabulous. And I see you've got batting stored under your cutting table.
Oh, yes. I've got my rolls on, I don't know, curtain rod things there, and just roll it out onto the table and cut it off.
And so that was just a kitchen table or a desk or something?
Yeah, it was a kitchen table. Yep.
Wonderful. Yeah, those old kitchen tables, solid wood, they're great for sewing rooms.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, well, show us what else is in that space.
Let's see. I like to keep flowers, more color, and just, you know, to keep the room happy. And just, I don't know.
Yeah. And then behind you, is there...
Behind me is...
Wait. Is that a groundhog?
What?
Wait, did you have a groundhog by your sewing machine?
This?
What?
Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah!
I don't know what that is, honestly. My son gave it to me for Christmas, and I opened it, and I said, what is it? And he's like, it's a, and I don't even remember what it's called. It's this weird thing. My son gave it to me, so I have it.
Very good. All right.
Yeah, and so I also love to do embroidery, so I have embroidery projects that I've done on the walls, and
wonderful.
These were like, for the whole year of 2017 and 2018, I stitched something each day.
Whoa!
So that was fun.
Yeah.
What else? Let's see, over here, well, here's a recent finish that's a good reminder.
Yeah, that's such a good reminder.
Yeah, and then my pressing station here, and where I hang up my client quilts and my stash.
Fabulous. So you do quilt for others?
I do, yes. Short story long arm quilting is the name of my business.
Wonderful. And where do you keep all your thread? Because I know you've got a lot of it and I haven't seen it yet.
It's in this bin.
Yeah.
So that's all my bobbin thread.
Oh, uh-huh.
And this is all my stash of.
Wonderful. All the purple thread. Do you have a favorite thread?
I'm using Glide right now. I'd like to experiment with other ones and see what my machine likes, but it seems to like Glide.
Sure. All right, well, and I see more things on the wall. I want to touch it.
Yeah.
And yeah. So you're all hand embroidery.
Yes. So this is turkey stitching, so it's really fuzzy.
Oh, yeah.
It's a quote from Monsters University.
Uh-huh. Very cool. All right. Well, will you turn the camera around so we can see your smiling face?
Sure.
Yeah. So Emily, are there three things that you would recommend to your bestie right now? They don't have to be quilt related, but three favorite things you got going on?
Yes. So the things that I would recommend, as you can tell in my face, I like things that are meaningful to me, things that I find beautiful, and things that make me laugh. So the meaningful thing to me is, a year ago, I signed up for rookie season through Long Arm League.
Oh, sure,
and
yeah.
That has helped me. I mean, that is what got me to start this business. Like, all of the support that I need, and I have a group of other Long Armers, business buddies, who I can text whenever and be like, what do you do when this happens? So I highly recommend, if anybody's wanting to start a business with long arming, rookie season and long arm league.
Fantastic.
And then beautiful. So I recommend that pattern that I was working on, the Plains and Pine Big Sky Star Quilt. So it's a Lone Star, which I'd never tackled that kind of piecing before. But she really, she has a workshop that I recommend.
Okay.
That really walks you through each step of it. And then The thing that I recommend about making me laugh, I was trying to think, like, I watch movies and listen to podcasts and all this stuff, and the thing that I thought that makes me laugh the most, though, is, like, my friends and family. Yep. I find that I laugh the hardest with the people that I love. So my recommendation is put down the phone, spend some time with your friends and family who make you laugh.
Yeah. What great advice. Yeah. Yeah. And I love in your studio, you have all those little personal touches. From, I saw you had little foxes up above as well. So you've got lots of personal expression in there, in addition to all of your creative expression, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining me, Emily. I really appreciate your time. I love your space. You've really been able to carve out distinct areas of your studio for your piecing and your storage, as well as your long arm machine. So I just appreciate your time. And we'll see you around the clubhouse.
All right. Thank you so much.
Okay. All right. See you, Emily. Bye.
Thank you so much, Emily, for letting us into your space. The cardboard cutout of the Queen of England just absolutely cracked me up. And I think it might spook me in the middle of the night if I were to walk downstairs into my sewing space and see Queen Elizabeth in the corner. I loved your space, especially Emily. You found ways to bring such personal touches into every corner. And I know that is a space that makes you smile and that makes you feel creative. And that's really all anyone could ask, is have a personal reflection in their sewing room. So thank you so much, Emily. That was great. I wanted to talk to you guys about some new arrivals. We did have a new line of thread come in the door. So it is a Glide glow-in-the-dark thread. It's Glide Luminary, and we have it in a variety of colors. So it glows in the dark. So imagine how stinking cute would it be to do a kiddo quilt and to stitch I love you or their name or any other little message in the quilt that they can only find when the lights go out for 99 time. Wouldn't that be great? Or stars. I mean, there's so many things that you could do with it. So those are the Glide Luminary glow in the dark threads. And then we just got in how many bolts of Painter's Palette Solids?
Another 35.
105 bolts of the Painter's Palette Solids, so the 45s in all different colorways, and they are gorgeous sitting on the shelf. So if you're looking for solids, I really like that, the hand of the Painter's Palette Solids. And then we did have a pre-cut walk in the door. It was the Twinkle Charm Pack, and it's just precious. It's absolutely adorable. So those are those 5-inch charm packs. And then our new kit is the Scrappy Dashing Through the Snow. And it is an interesting way to make a churn dash. The directions show you how to make a churn dash in a way that you may not have made before. And it's a double churn dash. So there's a little baby churn dash inside and then the mama churn dash. And it's all in the Kimberbell Cup of Cheer fabric line that is in the kit, along with our original pattern, the Scrappy Dashing Through the Snow kit. And if you are enjoying the Quilted Joy Clubhouse and you find what we talk about and chat about to be interesting and helpful to you, I would ask you to review us on Google. The big Google machine decides who to serve up based on what other people say about that particular company. So if you leave us a review there on Google, it really does help us grow, and I sincerely appreciate it. And I read everyone personally, so I appreciate your time with leaving us a link. And of course, the best possible compliment would be to share this with someone that you know would enjoy the content. So if there's a friend that you quilt with that you think would find our topics interesting, just send them a link, and I appreciate it. I thank you very much. We are a tiny little quilt shop with mighty dreams, and you're helping us reach those goals. Okay, so we have a design along going on right now. And if you're in our newsletter, you got the information about how to vote for the layout you liked for the birds in the air block. And we got so many people who voted on which layout that they liked the best. And I want to share with you what the winning layout is. All right, it was winning layout was number 3. So this is the birds in the air block, and it's just rotated, how it's rotated. What's so great about this particular block is that you can get so many different looks out of it, just how you rotate the birds in the air block. And these are 6-inch finished birds in the air. And as I told you in the pattern, I'm gonna show you how to do it 4 at a time. And you can get this free when you sign up to vote on this next part of the process. So What I've done is I've taken the winner of the layouts, and I'm going to show you four different ways to quilt it. And then you will vote on which way you like best, and then I will quilt it that way. All right, so birds in the ear block, when you sign up to vote on which quilting design you like on this layout, you will get that birds in the ear four at a time pattern free in your inbox. So make sure you vote, okay? Let's take a look at the four choices that you're gonna have when you go to vote. The four choices on the design layout for the quilting motif that you are going to have a choice for. So here we have our birds in the air block that we've laid out, and it is, oh, I can't remember how many of those birds in the air blocks there are. 48, thank you, Ashley. So there's 48 6-inch birds of the air block. And so the first thing I did when I was looking at this as far as design is, of course, that white space really hops out. I'm not hooked up? Oh.
But we have the patterns on the screen.
Oh, okay. Well, you should be able to see my screen. You can see it? Okay. All right. So here's that birds in the air block. And what immediately drew my eye to was the white space. And how could I treat that white space? And so one of the things that we've talked about in the past was E's and L's. And I thought, well, this is a perfect place to go. E, L, E, and then even come down here. E, L, E, E, L, E. All right, so I thought that's a good way to fill all of that white space. So let's take a look at what that looks like. So there's my E's and my L's in the white space all along. And now the next thing I thought about was, how am I gonna treat those little half square triangle portions of it? And maybe I should zoom in here a little bit so you can see that a little bit better. So my next question was, what am I gonna do about these little half square triangles? And really what I thought is, if I could do a figure eight, and at this point I'm just trying to get a design, I'm not trying to really think about the path yet. And so, well, if I put a little figure eight here in each of those, that would be a nice way to kind of tie those together. And then I thought, okay, but if I need to do that, what would the path be? How would I get there? Because really there's some magic portals here. There's this one in this corner, right, to dip into that figure eight. There's the middle. And then there's this side here. And of course, the middle doesn't make any sense because I don't have anything coming into the middle, but I could possibly get something coming into either this portal, magic portal, or this magic portal. And so I thought, well, when I come in here to this pinwheely kind of point, maybe what I want to do is just kind of do a little bunny hop over, and that would get me to where I could do my figure eight, and then I could bunny hop out. So let's do it over here. So I could bunny hop over, figure eight, and then bunny hop out, and I'm ready to do my next E and L, bunny hop, bunny hop. Okay, so let me show you how all of that looks. So I'm gonna actually turn off my drawing layer, and I'm gonna turn on, there's my figure eights. I'm gonna zoom out one more time, and I'm gonna just kind of pan down here so you can see a little bit better. And then there's my little connectors. And that really kind of gives that almost a ladder or trellis effect in there. And then I thought, well, what about a border? What kind of border am I gonna do? Because I have a lot of kind of curves. And so the border that I came up with was just a swag. And we did the swag in a former episode where we talked about swags. And the corners, I turned the corners by just going with a curved arc point out in each of the four corners. So there you go. That's number one. All right, let me turn off those layers because you're gonna vote on which one that you like. So I'm gonna turn off those layers, and now we're gonna look at number two. Okay, so for this next one, what I thought is, all right, let's go with something a little more modern, maybe a little more straight. And so I took these white spaces and I went like that. Little chevrons across, and then I thought, well, when I got to the end, really, I think I want to go back. And so I'm doing echoed chevrons in the white. All right, so let me show you how that looks. I'm going to take those away so I can show you the, I'm going to turn them on so you can see them already drawn. So there you go. And that really kind of started to spin that larger white pinwheel that I hadn't really noticed before. And then it kind of showed me that there's another pinwheel, a kind of a aqua pinwheel in the middle. And so I'm going to zoom in here. So I thought, well, for that aqua pinwheel that's in the middle, really what I'd like to do is put a little curl in that aqua pinwheel to bring the aqua pinwheel out. All right, so let's take a look at what that would look like. So there's my pinwheels. And that just leaves me with those half square triangles again. And so I think what I'd like to do is a stacked curl. So curl one direction and then curl the other direction and then come down to the base and then curl in one direction and then curl in the opposite direction and then come down to the base. And so sprinkle those throughout all of those half square triangles. Okay, so let's take a look at what that looks like. And I'm going to zoom out so that you can see that. So there's my curls and my pinwheels and my curls and my half square triangles with the more structured stacked chevrons in the white. And as far as the border goes, I thought, well, I'll just repeat those chevrons in the outside border. So we did swags before, curve, but now I'm kind of playing off those sharp angles that I was using in the white and drawing those out to the outside border. And then the four corners are diamonds with a nested chevron inside. So that's how I would do. That's number two, that's choice number two. All right, let's look at choice number three. So I'm gonna turn off all of those. Okay, so for number three, again, I'm playing with that kind of white space, and I thought, well, really what might be fun is if I could bunny hop over to the center, which is already there from that half square triangle, and then go up to that point, come back down to the base, and bunny hop over. Bunny hop to that point, then go out to that corner, and then bunny hop over. Bunny hop, go out to the corner, come back, bunny hop, and on and on and on and I go. All right, so let me show you what that looks like. Oh, that's the wrong one, sorry. There we go, okay. So then I started thinking about those half square triangles again, and what could I do in the half square triangles? And I thought, well, my entry point could be, I have a little magic portal that I could enter them, either here, when I come in for that bunny hop, or here, where those tips point together. And so what I thought about doing is when I come in here, I could just do that same stacked chevron. So I could come out and just do a diamond shape. I don't know that I'm gonna stack them, but I'm just gonna do a diamond shape out here. All right, so let me zoom out because I want you to see what that looks like. Take that one off and I'm gonna turn on. I did it as a two again. There I go. So there's those diamond shapes. And then the last thing that I want to look at is the border. So I didn't feel a need to do anything in those small triangles on each side. This is a 6-inch block, so those are fairly small little triangles. So I thought if I kept them unquilted, they would kind of have some dimensionality to them that might be interesting. So I left those unquilted, but as far as the border goes, there's the border. So it's just repeating that bunny hop and that petal shape, and then the bunny hop, petal shape, bunny hop, and then in those four corners, just that petal shape out to the four corners. So that is number three. All right, so now let's go and let's look at number four. So I'm gonna turn all of these off, and then I started thinking, okay, what can I do in those white spaces that might be kind of fun and cool? And so I thought, well, if I do a little curl here and then a little kick out and then a curl here and then a kick out, I could actually put a pinwheeled feather in each of these white half square triangles. Come down. And so I'm curling into the triangle. If you notice, like when I have a choice, I curl into the triangle, come down. So then one more side, curl, curl, come down. And that way I can have a spinning feather in all those blocks. All right, let's take that off and let's turn on the spinning feather. So there we go. There's my spinning feather. I'm gonna zoom out so you can see it a little bit better. Okay, so I've got feathers in my pinwheels, and now what am I gonna do with those half square triangles? And I thought, you know what I wanna do is this is gonna be dense quilting, right? This is gonna be pretty highfalutin quilting. So how do I kind of elevate the half square triangles in that same manner? And so I'm gonna zoom in here, and what I thought I would do is actually a shaded half square triangle. So what I thought about doing was coming in to this half square triangle, and I'm gonna come in from a corner and I'm gonna go in just a little, and I'm gonna make a square, a smaller half square triangle. And then I'm gonna do a little micro stipple to mash down and kind of push that back from the eye so that this unquilted half square triangle kind of raises up to the eye and fills in. Okay, so then I thought, how do I get there? How do I get to the space where I can drop in and make this kind of framed out half square triangle? And I thought, okay, where are my entry points? And here is a giant entry point. So let's take a look at how I got to that shaded half square triangle. And that was just with the letter E. So I just went, when I got to that magic portal, right, I just went letter E, and then I came in, I did that half square triangle, and then I did some micro stippling around it to kind of mash it down, and then an E to get out, and an E, and that gave me the entries way to do that one, and then some micro stipples to mash it down, and an E to get out. So there you go. Let's take a look at the border, because of course, if I'm doing feathers in the blocks, I'm gonna do something in the border. So I did some just traditional diagonal cross hatching there in the border to kind of tie it all together. And since it is 6-inch blocks and there's an even number on each side, it just makes it super duper easy to do a diagonal crosshatch. So that is number 4. All right, so which one did you like? 1, 2, 3, or 4? Which one would you pick if it was your quilt? I want you to go and vote. We have this over on our blog, and so you can go and see pictures of all of these different choices. And then at the bottom, you just put your email address in, and that will allow you to vote, and it will get you our weekly newsletter where we have all of our goodies, and we will announce which design won during our December Clubhouse, which is on December the 7th. And we'll do that at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. So I'm interested. Did anybody put in the comments, Jesse, which one that they like the best? One vote for layout one. Yeah?
Yeah.
So be sure to go vote, and whatever way wins, then I will actually quilt that. So when you sign up, you'll get that how to make birds in the air block 4 at a time, and then when we gather back together here in 2 weeks on November the 16th at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific, I'll walk you through the step outs of how to actually get that block, that traditional birds in the air block, 4 at a time. It's amazing. All right, you guys, I look forward to seeing you next month on December the 7th, Wednesday, December the 7th at 1 o'clock Eastern. And then, of course, join us over on Facebook. We have our Facebook page where you can find out what's happening there in the shop, and our Facebook group, the Quilted Joy Clubhouse, over on Facebook. You can find us on Instagram as well, where we have a lot of great photos, especially of our renters who come in and use our machines on Instagram. And then over on YouTube, that's where you will find all of the previous recordings of the Quilted Joy Clubhouse, as well as mini tutorials that I think you'll find helpful. Next month, we're going to talk about a different ruler. It's the petunia.